Glad to have you with us, and thanks for tuning in. It's Tuesday, the 18th day of February, and how many of you might not have had as productive of a day, well, than maybe yesterday? A lot of folks did because the weather complemented what they were doing. It worked well to be outside working today. For some of us, it was a little hard to get some work done. Oh, a beautiful day in the neighborhood. We've got more of the same. A lot of sunshine, temperatures in the 60s, I'm going to say in the 70s. Might be just a tiny bit of a stretch, but maybe not. And we've also got some showers, maybe some severe weather later on Thursday night. We're still trying to keep a monitor on, but no snow in the forecast whatsoever. Now, don't be fooled. Winter is going to make a return, and when it does, it may stick around through the better part of, well, the end of February and through maybe even most all, if not all, of the month of March. But for now, we have a little bit of a reprieve, and I'll be glad to fill you in about your weather forecast in just a few moments. A whole lot of ground to cover tonight. We'll be talking with an area business who was very pleased to hear of the Appalachia Proud announcement yesterday on behalf of Kentucky Agriculture Commissioner James Comer. We'll talk about what they hope it will do for their business. An auto accident this morning. I've got highlights for you from last night's senior night and a whole lot of news and information. Now, looking ahead, just to let you know, and I'll have one of this on the calendar, a reminder that the McGaughey County Fiscal Court meets in regular session tomorrow afternoon at 1. We'll have a report to follow. But I started a report today. I have it mostly filmed and done about a movement to try to allow horse-drawn carriages and buggies on the Dawkins Rail to Trail line here in McGaughey County, in Johnson for that matter, and that's going to make a very nice story, and it also ties into a major upcoming event that I'll be announcing to you very soon. Also some other information as well, other big stories that we're working on for the rest of the week, and we'll get to all of that in just a few moments. First off, U.S. Senator Rand Paul, while he was in Knott County yesterday in support of the Appalachian Proud campaign announcement, he was set to be in front of a Senate committee today. It was there today that he was going to show his support for a proposed constitutional amendment that would restore voting rights for some felons. The senator was invited to make the remarks in front of the state Senate committee, partly for his belief that voting rights, he believes, are considered sacred. And currently, while felons can have their right to vote restored here in Kentucky, if granted so by the governor, an example would be in Bath County, most recently where the former Bath County attorney, Donald Mays, the former sheriff, Calvin Randall Armitage, and Norman Crouch have all filed to run in the upcoming election in May for judge, executive, sheriff, and jailer after having their rights restored by Governor Beshear after each of the three were convicted for their parts in a 2006 vote-buying scheme. The bipartisan bill would allow Kentucky voters to restore voting rights to more than 180,000 nonviolent felons across the Commonwealth. It has passed its first hurdle this legislative session. House Bill 70, sponsored by Representative Jesse Crenshaw of Lexington and House Minority Leader Jeff Hoover of Jamestown, cleared the Kentucky House by a vote of 82-12. Should it become law, voters will be able to decide by statewide ballot in the next general election, that's November the 4th, whether or not to approve a state constitutional amendment that would automatically restore the right to vote for Kentucky's nonviolent felons.
The amendment would apply only to nonviolent felons who have served their sentences or completed the requirements of probation or parole. It would also exclude felons convicted of rape, sodomy, intentional murder, or sexual contact with a minor. Crenshaw said it's a matter of fairness that those who have paid their debt be able to take part and make their own governance. And ladies and gentlemen, that is what he says House Bill 70 is all about. House Bill 70 received vocal support from Representative David Floyd of Bardstown, who has supported similar legislation filed by Crenshaw in past sessions. Floyd reportedly told the House that there is, quote, no political consideration that can push aside my sense that a debt paid is a debt satisfied. House Bill 70 now goes to the Senate for its consideration. Another bill on the books, so to speak, a bill that would allow low-level, one-time Kentucky felons to ask the courts to seal or expunge their felony record has also passed the House Judiciary Committee this legislative session. It's House Bill 64 and is sponsored by Representative Darrell Owens of Louisville, and it would apply to Class D felons whose conviction was not based on a sex offense, crime against the elderly, or crime against a child, who completed their sentence of probation of at least 5 years prior and who was not convicted of a felony before their conviction and has not been convicted of a felony, misdemeanor, or any violation since. It would also apply to those for whom felony charges did not result in an indictment and would provide discrimination protection for felons whose records have been expunged. The bill would apply to any eligible felon regardless of how many decades have passed since their conviction. As many as 94,000 individuals could be eligible for expungement under the legislation. Current Kentucky law only allows expungement in misdemeanor cases. Magoffin County school teacher on her way to work this morning encountered a stretch of slick roadway, some ice still in a sheltered area. Once that happened, she lost control of her vehicle. It overturned, causing serious damage to the car, while a motorist and a neighbor in the area, so to speak, also on her way to work, was the first to arrive at the scene.
There you can see some considerable ice still on the road of Johnson Fork in Magoffin County. Coming out of that curve, this stretch leads into another curve where another similar patch of ice caused Pam Patrick of Magoffin County to lose control of her vehicle on her way to teach school this morning. Very fortunate to be not seriously injured. A resident in the area, a friend of ours, Sandy Reynolds, was on her way dropping off her exchange student at school and then on her way to work and encountered the vehicle as you see here. She told me off camera that Patrick was conscious and alert, visibly and understandably shaken up after the accident. She was wearing her seatbelt, as we understand, which goes a long way to her non-life-threatening injuries. She was taken to an area hospital, the Morgan County ARH, I believe, for just observation to make sure that she was okay, but she was the only one in the vehicle. No other vehicles were involved, but you can see the serious damage and the crushing to the roof of the car that was sustained after her vehicle left the roadway, apparently rolling over and being crushed by either the road or the hillside or both. Once again, she was in the vehicle upon arrival of emergency personnel or out shortly before, but was taken by ambulance for non-life-threatening injuries.
More news after these words.
This year, W2 means we double. Hutch Chevrolet Buick GMC will double your tax return up to $1,000. With more, here's Earl Justice.
Find 200 of our most popular vehicles with payments starting at just $149 a month with zero down. Plus, all sales decision in 15 minutes or less, or I'll give you the vehicle.
This double your tax return event ends in 2 weeks at Hutch Chevrolet Buick GMC in Paintsville, Kentucky. Isn't it time to buy Hutch?
Game time means wing time at Lee's, and that means it's time for you to try our new buffalo wings. I can't tell you our secret, but I can tell you they're marinated and then rolled in our famous, albeit a little spicy, crispy chicken batter and served up with any of our 7 delectable sauces. So get your hands on a meal or a box today at your Sagersville Lee's Famous Recipe, where no one does chicken like we do chicken. Faster, friendlier, family-owned Parkway Pharmacy, open 8:30 till 6:30 Monday through Friday in the new Magoffin Medical Plaza under the care of local pharmacist Jesse Rudd. To make Parkway Pharmacy your pharmacy, come by or give us a call at 349-4400.
Have you ever noticed how many insurance commercials and advertisements are on television nowadays? You can't watch your favorite program without seeing a little pig or green lizard trying to sell you insurance and get your money for their premiums. But let me ask you this. If you have been in a serious wreck, do you really think that you are in good hands of the insurance companies when you have lost wages, medical bills, and pain and suffering from your head to your toes? The answer is no. If you want to truly be in good hands, give me a call. I'm attorney Donald Wayne McFarland. Let me put my 20 years of experience in working to protect the rights of injured people to work for you. 349-9000.
At the end of every race, Mark Martin hangs up his driving gloves. He hangs up his fire suit. And he hangs up his helmet. Which is why he picks up his phone and opens the ER Extra app. The app shows ER Extra wait times, locations, and more. It's the one safeguard Mark Martin is never without. ER Extra at Paul B. Hall Regional Medical Center. Extra fast, extra easy, extra great.
From time and money-saving services like their overdraft protection, telephone and online banking services, to finding the right home, college, or car loan, to personalized checking and savings accounts designed around your exact needs, Sagersville National Bank is still your best choice and the same locally owned and operated bank that's been looking out for your family's financial health since 1902. Sagersville National, restoring the piggy bank population one savings at a time.
Well, as the old saying goes, there's more than one way to skin a cat, or is it more than one way to eat a pickle? I'm not quite sure, but New Jersey has found itself in a real pickle this evening because a rule of the high seas has literally stopped a shipment of salt to keep their roads clear. So state officials are now being forced to turn to pickle juice to try to treat their roads and de-ice them while trying to get a federal waiver to clear up a 40,000-ton shipment of rock salt that's being held up on sea. The salt is sitting in a port in Maine until New Jersey officials can obtain this federal waiver. It's being held up because it's sitting on a vessel that wasn't flying an American flag, and that is a direct violation of the 1920 Maritime Act. So New Jersey Transportation Commissioner Jim Simpson said in an interview this week that the nearest U.S.-flagged vessel that could get them salt was more than a month away by sea, and that the state, slated for another round of wintry weather today, had to come up with something. And they did. For now, they are using pickle juice as a way to treat their roads. Oh, this is so cool. And it's not the first time they've had to do it either. Back in 2011, they had 230 snow plows all full of pickle juice because they didn't have enough salt then. Pickle juice costs about 7 cents a gallon, and salt costs about $63 a ton. For its part, the acidic combo may actually be better for the environment as a way to de-ice the roads. A study by Marquette University shows that while salting snowy roads can cut down on accidents up to 88%, sodium chloride stays in the ground, seeping into streams, eating into the concrete and asphalt, and of course eating into your cars, and pickle juice doesn't necessarily do any of that. Out of Nashville, Tennessee, when Tennesseans statewide spring forward into daylight savings time next month, they will never, ever fall back to standard time again under legislation that has cleared the first step toward passage in their state's General Assembly. Representative Curry Todd of Collierville said it will be a great deal for farmers. It will be great for school kids, as he's talked to many businesses and folks across the state about this, and he's not got one negative comment about the bill. As amended in the House State Government Subcommittee, the bill simply decrees or declares that Tennessee will drop out of the ritual of moving their clocks forward an hour each year on the second Sunday in March, then back again on the first Sunday in November. The bill takes effect July the 1st, and since daylight saving time will be in place on that date, the effect will be making daylight saving time permanent. Todd says that federal law allows states to make such moves as long as the state is in two different time zones, as Tennessee is, the eastern time zone in East Tennessee and the central time zone in the middle and western part of the state. Arizona, Hawaii, and Indiana have successfully adopted a uniform time system with no changes by season, and he says Tennessee should do the same. The bill prompted some joking and a few expressions of skepticism, according to the report, during the committee debate, but ultimately it was approved with only 2 votes to the negative. They said afterward that concerns were that Tennessee having a different time arrangement than other states may have a potential negative impact on commerce, but some of them were persuaded to go the other way after the subcommittee vote today. One of the members put it on Facebook seeking comments. 70% were in favor of the bill, 30% were against.
We'll hear from the Chop Shop with other local and top stories in just a few moments. Right now, I'm going to switch over to tonight's community calendar, a little off schedule, but we do have, as always, several announcements, including a birthday to kick it all off, brought to you by McGoffin Farm Bureau. And it's a happy 29th birthday to Wayne McDowell, with a lot of love from your mom, your brother, and your family and friends. Happy, happy birthday to you. Wayne McDowell's 29. Happy birthday. Kicking off the rest of the calendar, I've got a found in the lost and found department. I'm told this is a black and tan dog, looks to be a young dog, has a green collar, and it's been found in the Elk Creek Road area. This is your pet. This is the number you need to call. Ask for Sheila, 349-7397. That's 7397 for a found black and tan dog with a green collar. And our friends at the Water Into Wine Food Pantry are distributing food boxes tomorrow, 8 a.m. until 4 p.m. They will break for lunch for an hour in between from noon to 1. This is at the Lakefront Church, the old Middle Fork Elementary School. Food boxes given out tomorrow, Wednesday, February the 19th. McGaughey County Fiscal Court is to meet in regular session tomorrow. Got the agenda here in front of me. I'll be there and have a report to follow. They'll be discussing bridges, roads, a resolution for a fallen soldier, soil conservation, the Civil War Park project, and the reenactment in April to be discussed tomorrow. Look for a big announcement there. That will also be a lead-in to a report that I referred to at the top of the program. Also, a land purchase for transportation to be discussed in the morning, once again during a regular session. And McGaughey County 4-H is going to the Olympics. Well, at home they're going to the Olympics. That's not a stretch. Come celebrate 4-H Health Month and the Winter Olympics this Thursday, 4:30 at your McGaughey County Extension Office with 4-H Olympic-themed games. A whole lot of fun to be had. 349-3216 if you've got any questions at all. And a big chili dinner has been put together on behalf of the Elk Creek Church. It is set for this Friday, 9 in the morning till 5. You can eat in, carry out, or they will deliver. All you have to do is call them. There's the numbers, 349-8637 or 205-4914. Remember, that's the Elk Creek Church, and it's this Friday beginning at 9 in the morning. The McGaughey County High School graduating class of 1984 has a reunion planning meeting set for this Sunday, 4 o'clock at the Sagerville Subway. All classmates are invited to attend and help with the planning process and to set a date for the reunion. So they need you there. They need your input. They need your help. They need you. Your news today, Post Office Box 1443 in Sagersville. My phone number, 349-3699. The fax is 349-3221. Your news today at yahoo.com is an email address that will get it here. I'm on Facebook under Ritter Mortimer. You can always drop it off at the newsroom. Any of those ways will get your calendar announcement on the show. Funeral service announcements this Tuesday, February 18th, brought to you by the McGaughey County Funeral Home, including announcements in honor of 83-year-old Jack Austin Allen of Sagersville, who passed away on February the 16th. He's survived by his wife, Phyllis Arnett Allen, son, Barry Jack Allen, and daughter, Jill Allen Ward. Visitation continues this evening and up until services will begin in the morning at 11 o'clock, all of which from the McGaughey County Funeral Home. 52-year-old Robert Franklin of Rockhouse Creek Road in Sagersville passed away on Tuesday, February the 11th. He is left to mourn by his sister Charlene Franklin, brother Timothy Franklin, and a host of family and friends. Graveside services for Robert are to be held tomorrow, 11 a.m. from the family cemetery on Hammond's Fork off Rockhouse Road here in Sagersville.
It's definitely the pie that sets it apart from everything you've ever known, tasted, or loved about a Reese's Cup or a DQ Blizzard. Real Reese's Peanut Butter Cups, creamy vanilla soft serve, and a real crunchy graham pie crust that gives it the texture and taste you'll never forget. But hurry, because it's the Blizzard of the Month at your Sagersville Dairy Queen.
Howdy, Hatfield. I reckon I'll take my pig back.
Ain't your pig.
Yeah, it is.
No, it ain't.
Yeah, it is, and I can prove it. Ma, I just sent a picture of our missing pig. Tell everybody it's time to start feuding.
Oh, for heaven's sake.
I guess ain't gonna be no feud. Real nice picture, though.
We'll put it on Instagram.
Appalachian Wireless's 4G. Great pictures, video, text, and talk. Bigger savings, better service. That's today's Appalachian Wireless.
Attention candidates, for whatever you want to get your name and message on, shirts, caps, pins, matches, cozies, and more, call Avavian Deaton, and she can tell you about her campaign special. That's 72 caps and 24 t-shirts delivered to your door for a limited time low price of just $3.99. Call Avavian, 349-3835.
The New Year's sales event rolls on at Conley's with 3.99% and up to $1,000 in rebates on new Polaris's. Kawasaki's got 3.95% or save up to $1,500 in cash. And just in, Polaris Power digital inverter generators, ultra quiet and ultra affordable at Conley's, Kawasaki, and Polaris of Paintsville. Always the best selection of hand-picked, quality, pre-owned cars, trucks, and SUVs, all with the service, prices, and financing aimed at making sure you drive off with the deal and vehicle you've been looking for. Premier Motors in Paintsville, 297-4121.
brought you some great depth in coverage last evening in regards to the announcement of Appalachia Proud, the campaign unveiled yesterday by State Agriculture Commissioner James Comer, as well as a host of other groundbreaking announcements that they all hope to see become a reality in Kentucky sometime in the future. But Appalachia Proud was the centerpiece of yesterday's event, one that has caught the eye of a lot of Kentucky businesses, like the Chop Shop in Morgan County.
As Agriculture Commissioner Comer told me yesterday, they've already got a host of Kentucky vendors under the Appalachian Proud moniker and family, and they hope to add many soon. They're going to begin an aggressive campaign immediately with the hopes of adding as many Kentucky businesses as possible and watching them each and every one grow, including the Chop Shop in Hazel Green.
We're giving people stickers today, so all those vendors that are over there are now Appalachia Proud vendors, and you'll see there's that branding initiative on their product today.
And what about for the folks who want to become involved?
Our website, get on our website, and we can get them signed up. We have staff here today, and they're not going to leave till the last person leaves. Anybody that needs help getting signed up or help marketing their product, or if they just have an idea, we're going to work with them to help them succeed.
And one of those vendors from our area that was there yesterday, the Chop Shop from Hazel Green.
The Chop Shop is a USDA inspected facility. It does all the commercial slaughtering as well as retail slaughtering. It's different outlets of marketing beef, pork, lamb, and goat. Also, it does a lot of different specialty type meats such as sausages, smoked goods, smoked hams. So much more to offer than just a regular small packing house.
Marcellette's been a business person and an entrepreneur in Kentucky for many, many years, and he sees the Appalachian Proud campaign as a positive step towards the future of the Chop Shop and other Kentucky businesses.
Well, it's going to generate more jobs for Eastern Kentucky, not just the Hazel Green area, but it's also going to help people in McAuliffe County. It's going to help the farmers. It's going to give them a better outlet for their cattle. Other than just taking them to the stockyard and selling them at feeders. The Chop Shop's going to need larger grain-fed animals for different wholesalers, and there's different advantages to that. Wholesalers are looking for locally grown products. Also, the wholesalers are wanting to get grants and monies involved in our school systems where we take this product to the schools.
Something that everyone thought was worth celebrating. Now, as far as the Chop Shop goes, well, I'm going to be taking a little bit of a tour of the facility sometime in the relatively near future. Look for that report coming soon. Right now, so says your Licking Valley RECC forecast, you can look for increasing clouds. We saw a beautiful day today, 62 degrees at the newsroom. That's worth celebrating. It's going to be relatively short-lived in the grand scheme of things. It's going to be a few more days. But anyway, I'm getting ahead of myself, and that's not necessarily always a good thing. A low tonight of 44 degrees. Some isolated showers between midnight and 2 a.m. and a few scattered thereafter. Maybe even a small thunderstorm thereafter as well. That low of 44, no severe weather to speak of tonight. That comes a little later on in the forecast period by the time we get to Thursday night. But first, we have to cover your tomorrow. We'll see 60 degrees, maybe even a bit more than that tomorrow. Those scattered showers and thunderstorms might hang around until 9, 10 o'clock in the morning. But otherwise, will become partly sunny, west wind 7 to 9 miles per hour. Mild in comparison to later on in the week. It's going to be a nice day, a little slow getting there on the onset due to the possibility of those scattered showers, maybe even a thunderstorm or two. Nothing of a severe nature right now. Becoming partly sunny, a nice end to your Wednesday with a low of 39. Now, after 4 o'clock Wednesday morning, well, we get in on another slight chance of some showers. And that carries us, though, only into your early morning Thursday hours. Thursday will clear up quickly, mostly sunny above. It says 69, but I couldn't do it. I had to put in 70. I think we're going to get there. Regardless, it looks so much better. Break the shorts out at least for a day. Mostly sunny skies. You'll get to enjoy part of your Thursday. But Thursday night, a 40% chance of showers is going to develop actually in the afternoon, 3 or 4 o'clock for us. We'll still see some sunshine with that. Clouds will start to move in. They'll do it real quickly, along with some winds gusting upwards of 25, 30 miles per hour. And then showers and possibly some thunderstorms, possibly during the overnight Thursday. We're talking about a squall line of storms, a slight tornado threat as of right now that can't be ruled out, but it's still several hours away. Tomorrow, obviously, we'll know more and can better warn you about what's happening for Thursday and Thursday night. But tomorrow's gorgeous. Thursday looks to be maybe at least half gorgeous and the warmest day we've had in a long, long time. Now, on the backside of all that rough weather, we'll calm down just a bit temperature-wise, too. 53, 33 for your high and low Friday, mostly sunny. 60% chance of some early storms still lingering from Thursday night. But otherwise, we'll see skies clearing. We'll see mostly clear skies by Friday night. Into your Saturday, mostly sunny and 56. It's going to be nice again. 20% chance of some showers late. Clouds are going to increase Saturday night, taking us into Sunday. A bit cooler, 48, partly sunny, a bit closer to average, a low of 27. Another slight chance of some showers. That 48-degree high on Sunday falls to 42 Monday, to 41 on Tuesday. Oh, and we might continue to follow that trend right on down the line, sad to say. But for now, that's my time. A great deal of news is that I've referred to, I guess, on a couple of different occasions tonight, all beginning tomorrow night when I see you then. Thanks for watching.